The divide and conquer approach makes solving certain types of problems very efficient by dividing them into smaller, more manageable subproblems, conquering each problem independently, and then combining the results to resolve the original problem. In the merge sort algorithm we met in the last video, this saved having to make multiple passes through the data, rechecking the order of items we had already sorted. In other words, the results of work done in one stage were reused and built on in the next. We're now going to apply the same principle to the discrete Fourier transform and explore how and why the divide process in the FFT differs slightly from what we saw in merge sort. Along the way, we'll see just how easy it is to conquer a DFT with only two samples. So, what makes the FFT's divide stage different from merge sort? The answer lies in an inherent property of the phase relationships between the sines and cosines of the Fourier transform. Unlike the merge sort algorithm, which repeatedly splits the elements into left and right halves, in the fast Fourier transform, the elements of the array are split into even and odd samples. A cosine wave is an even function. This means that its values are symmetric around the y-axis. To put it mathematically, we can say that the cosine of minus theta is equal to the cosine of theta. A sine wave, on the other hand, is an odd function. Its values are anti-symmetric around the origin. To get its negative half, we need to reflect it not only in the y-axis, but in the x-axis as well. Mathematically, we would say that the sine of minus theta is equal to minus the sine of theta. In the Fourier transform, a signal is broken down into its frequency components by measuring how much it correlates, how similar it is, to cosine and sine waves at each frequency. This is done by multiplying the signal by these waves and summing the results. Splitting the signal into even and odd indices in the FFT exploits the symmetry of the cosine waves and the anti-symmetry of the sine waves in a computationally efficient way. We can clearly demonstrate this using our 8-sampled signal by examining how we begin calculating its DFT. Since we have 8 samples, the DFT will have 8 points, meaning we must multiply the signal by cosine and sine waves at each of the 8 sample points across 8 different frequencies, from index 0 to 7. Let's look at the cosine wave first. Notice that the samples in the signal that tend to align most strongly with the maxima and minima at each frequency are the even samples. While this isn't always perfectly true for every frequency, it is a general trend, and it's this tendency that the FFT exploits. As a result, the even samples contribute most strongly to the cosine component of the DFT. Now let's look at the sine wave. Here, the samples that tend to align most strongly with its maxima and minima at each frequency are the odd samples. This means that the odd samples contribute most strongly to the sine component of the DFT. This is why the FFT splits the samples into even and odd indices. It takes advantage of the distinct symmetry properties of cosine and sine waves. This approach wouldn't work if we split the signal into left and right halves, as we did in the merge sort algorithm. So now we've successfully divided the array into these sample pairs, we need to conquer the problem. The beauty of divide and conquer is that to conquer a DFT containing only 2 samples, otherwise known as a 2-point DFT, is simplicity itself. Here's why. In a 2-point DFT, we are dealing with only 2 samples, which means there are only 2 frequencies we can test, 0 and 1. This is because the DFT only analyzes frequencies for which the sines and cosines it uses complete whole cycles within the period of the signal. Although higher frequencies like 2 or 3 could fit into this period, they cannot be represented with only 2 points, as in a sampled signal, the points must be evenly spaced and sufficient in number to distinguish different frequencies without aliasing. There are not enough points to distinguish between frequencies like 1 and 3. To the DFT, these 2 frequencies appear identical. But take a look at the amplitudes of these points on a cosine wave. When the cosine wave's frequency is 0, both points have an amplitude of 1. This means that when we multiply them by the corresponding signal samples, we are simply multiplying by 1, leaving their values unchanged. To complete the DFT calculation for this frequency component, we just need to sum the two values. So at a frequency of 0, the cosine component is found by simply adding the amplitudes of these two samples. Now what about the sine component? Take a look at where these samples fall on a sine wave at a frequency of 0. They both land at 0. This means that when we multiply the signal by these values, the result is always 0. Summing the two zeros still gives 0, so there's no sine component at this frequency. Now let's move on to the next frequency, 1. What are the amplitudes of the two samples on a cosine wave at this frequency? Well, they are 1 and minus 1. Multiplying the corresponding signal samples by these values scales by 1 and minus 1 respectively. When we sum these results, the negative sign ensures that we are effectively computing the difference between the two samples. For the sine component at this frequency, we check the amplitudes of the sine wave at the two sample points. At frequency 1, the sine wave still has values of 0 at both these points. So just like before, multiplying by these values results in 0, and summing them still gives 0. This means that there is no sine component at this frequency either. This shows how simple a two-point DFT is to compute. The sum of the two samples gives the contribution of the frequency component at index 0, while the difference between them gives the contribution at frequency index 1. This two-point DFT is then applied to each pair of samples. But hang on, you might be saying, this cannot be right. Running a two-point DFT on the first group of samples, x0 and x4, that has some logic to it because look at where they sit in the signal. They are properly aligned with the maxima and minima of the cosine wave at all frequencies. However, this is not true of any other group of samples in the split signal. You're right, of course. To make the maxima and minima align, either we have to shift the cosine and sine waves, or we have to shift the signal to make the points line up. If this is true, how can this one-size-fits-all way of conquering the problem possibly work? Well, the short answer is that it can't, at least not without this phase shift. So how do we begin combining the results from the divide and conquer stage so we can climb back up the recursive tree to calculate the DFT for the entire signal? And how can we turn what we've learned into a practical piece of code that we can run on a computer? We'll explore the answers to all these questions in my premium course, where we'll dive into the FFT's inner butterfly, uncover the role of twiddle factors, our key to solving that one-size-fits-all problem, and discover how to turn the theory we have learnt into a fully functional FFT implementation. I'll also recommend tools for adapting the code to your preferred programming environment and guide you on optimizing it for greater efficiency. In this series, we've explored the core principles of the FFT, learned how Cooley and Tookie leveraged the symmetry of sines and cosines, and seen how they adapted Gauss's divide and conquer strategy to make the DFT more computationally efficient. But there's still more to uncover if we want to write our own FFT application. Join me as we dive even deeper into the inner workings of the FFT and find out how to build an implementation that you can tailor to your own specific needs.